So, what was it that allowed researchers to overcome the vanishing gradient problem? The answer to this question has two parts, the first of which involves a restricted Boltzmann machine. This is a method that can automatically find patterns in our data by reconstructing the input. Sounds complicated, but bear with me. We'll take a closer look. Geoff Hinton at the University of Toronto was one of the first researchers to devise a breakthrough idea for training deep nets. His approach led to the creation of the restricted Boltzmann machine, also known as the RBM. Because of his pioneering work, he's often referred to as one of the fathers of deep learning. An RBM is a shallow two-layer net. The first layer is known as the visible layer, and the second is called the hidden layer. Each node in the visible layer is connected to every node in the hidden layer. An RBM is considered restricted because no two nodes in the same layer share a connection. An RBM is the mathematical equivalent of a two-way translator. In the forward pass, an RBM takes the inputs and translates them into a set of numbers that encode the inputs. In the backward pass, it takes this set of numbers and translates them back to form the reconstructed inputs. A well-trained net will be able to perform the backwards translation with a high degree of accuracy. In both steps, the weights and biases have a very important role. They allow the RBM to decipher the interrelationships among the input features, and they also help the RBM decide which input features are the most important when detecting patterns. Through several forward and backward passes, an RBM is trained to reconstruct the input data. Three steps are repeated over and over through the training process. With a forward pass, every input is combined with an individual weight and one overall bias, and the result is passed to the hidden layer, which may or may not activate. Here's how it flows for the whole net. Next, in a backward pass, each activation is combined with an individual weight and an overall bias, and the result is passed to the visible layer for reconstruction. Here's how it flows back. At the visible layer, the reconstruction is compared against the original input to determine the quality of the result. RBMs use a measure called KL Divergence for step C. Steps A through C are repeated with varying weights and biases until the input and the reconstruction are as close as possible. Have you ever had to train an RBM in one of your own machine learning projects? Please comment and tell me about your experiences. An interesting aspect of an RBM is that the data does not need to be labeled. This turns out to be very important for real-world datasets like photos, videos, voices, and sensor data, all of which tend to be unlabeled. Rather than having people manually label the data and introduce errors, an RBM automatically sorts through the data, and by properly adjusting the weights and biases, an RBM is able to extract the important features and reconstruct the input. An important note is that an RBM is actually making decisions about which input features are important and how they should be combined to form patterns. In other words, an RBM is part of a family of feature extractor neural nets, which are all designed to recognize inherent patterns in data. These nets are also called autoencoders because, in a way, they have to encode their own structure. So we saw that an RBM can extract features, but how does that help with the vanishing gradient? We'll get to the second part of our answer in the next video when we take a look at the DeepLearning.TV net.